Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Meaning of Travel, Philosophers Abroad, by Emily Thomas, narrated by Esther Wane. Publisher's note: in this audio edition, you will hear references to figures present in the print and ebook formats of the book. Travelling well. Top 10 vintage tips. 1. Prohibit young people from travel. No young person under 40 is ever to be allowed to travel abroad under any circumstances, nor is anyone to be allowed to go for private reasons, but only on some public business, as a herald or ambassador, or as an observer of one sort or another. Plato, Republic, circa 380 BCE. 2. Avoid foreign novelties, customs, and affections. In manners or behaviour, your lordship must not be caught with novelty, which is pleasing to young men, nor infected with custom, which makes us keep our own ill graces, and participate of those we see every day, nor given to affectation, a general fault of most of our English travellers, which is both displeasing and ridiculous. Francis Bacon, Essays, 1597. 3. Consider the monsters. Have you considered all the dangers of so great an enterprise, the costs, the difficulty, the expectation, the conclusion, and everything else pertinent, and weighed them properly in your judgment? There is heaven, you say, but perhaps you can scarcely see it through the continuous darkness. There is earth, which you won't dare to tread upon, perhaps, because of the multitude of beasts and serpents. There are men, but you would prefer to do without their company. What if some Patagonian polyphemus, cyclops, were to tear you to pieces and then straightway devour the throbbing and still living parts? Joseph Hall, Another World and Yet the Same, 1605. 4. Prohibit fools, furious people, and women from travel. It may be doubted whether all persons may undertake travel, infants and decrepit persons, fools, madmen, and furious persons whose disabilities of mind are such as no hope can be expected for the one or other. Lastly, the sex in most countries prohibiteth women, who are rather for the house than the field. Thomas the Travailer Palmer, An Essay of the Means How to Make Our Travails into Foreign Countries the More Profitable and Honourable, 1606. 5. Map the Universe. It were of use to inform himself, before he undertakes his voyage, by the best chorographical and geographical map of the situation of the country he goes to, both in itself and relatively to the universe. Edward Lee, Three Diatribes, 1671. 6. Adopt local fashions and avoid being eaten. All persons that travel in Turkey must change their habit into that of the country, and must lay aside the hat and wear a turban, and the meaner the habit, the safer they will be from extortions and robberies. The best money they can carry are Spanish pieces of 8, provided they be full weight, and not of Peru. It is absolutely necessary to carry good arms to defend themselves upon all occasions, but more particularly to fight the Arabs and other rovers. Above all, it is requisite in Turkey that travellers be armed with patience to bear many affronts the infidels will put upon them, and with prudence and moderation to prevent, as much as possibly may be, any such insolences. When they travel with the caravan, they must take care never to be far from it, for fear of being devoured by wild beasts, or by the wilder Arabs. Anon, The History of Navigation, in a Collection of Voyages and Travels, 1704. 7. Fear not death. A young man is good constitution, who is bound on an enterprise sanctioned by experienced travellers, does not run very great risks. Let those who doubt refer to the history of the various expeditions encouraged by the Royal Geographical Society, and they will see how few deaths have occurred. Savages rarely murder newcomers. Francis Galton, The Art of Travel, 1855. 8. Pack sensibly for train journeys, and remember, ladies need more time. Divide your luggage into packages, and attach to the inner side of the lid of each package a list of the various articles which such package contains. Then number each package, and finally make a memorandum of these lots, with their corresponding numbers, in your pocketbook. Label your luggage legibly and boldly. Observe also that the name of the place should be in larger letters than the name of the person, and however much this may offend our self-esteem, it must be borne in mind that in the hurry and bustle of departure, the destination is what is first required to be known, the owner being a secondary consideration. Be on time. Trains wait for no man. And should there be ladies in the case, it is absolutely necessary to allow a wider margin for the preparations for departure than is ordinarily assigned. The fair sex must complete their toilet to their entire satisfaction, whatever the consequences may be. It should also be remembered that they do not enter into the spirit of the straight-laced punctuality observed by the railway authorities, and if the timetable sets down the departure at 1:20, they instinctively read 1:45. Anon, The Railway Traveller's Handy Book, 1862. 9. Avoid hurrying and worrying. The American who visits Europe for the first time is apt to be in a hurry and to endeavour to see too much. He will very likely return with a confused notion of his experiences and will be obliged to refer to his notebook to know what he has done. Instances have occurred of tourists who could not tell whether St. Paul's Cathedral was in London or Rome, and who had a vague impression that the tomb of Napoleon was beneath the Arc de Triomphe. Do not disturb yourself with unpleasant thoughts of what may happen in the fog. Remember, rather, that of the thousands of voyages that have been made across the Atlantic, only a few dozens have been unfortunate, and of all the steamers that have ploughed these waters, only the President, City of Glasgow, Pacific, Tempest, United Kingdom, City of Boston, and Ismailia, 7 in all, are unheard from. The chances are thousands to one in your favour. In regions where there are highwaymen, facetiously termed road agents by the Californians, carry as little money as possible, and leave your valuable gold watch behind. Generally, the first intimation of their presence is the profusion of several rifles or pistols into the windows of the coach, with a request, more or less polite, for you to hand over your valuables. When you have no alternative but to hand over, do so with alacrity, and lead your assailants to think it the happiest moment of your life. Thomas W. Knox. How to Travel. Hints, Advice and Suggestions to Travellers by Land and Sea All Over the Globe. 1881. 10. On trains, beware hats and ham sandwiches. Deerstalker caps are affected by many women in travelling, but suit very few. Avoid pastry as you would the plague. Sandwiches may be eaten, provided they are not of ham. Tea at the refreshment rooms of railway stations and on board steamboats is often a mere parody of the real article, a fearful decoction. Lilias Campbell Davidson, Hints to Lady Travellers, 1889. 1. Why do philosophers care about travel? The supreme moments of travel are born of beauty and strangeness. Robert Byron, First Russia, Then Tibet, 1933. The train wasn't crowded, but its passengers were loud. Two seats behind me, a couple were quarrelling over Trump and Hillary. Two seats ahead, a couple were noisily engaging in a sex act. This prompted a hushed debate across the aisle. She has her face in his pants. Well, dear, all the more reason not to talk to her. The whispers dragged my gaze to the window again. It was early spring, ice breakup season in Alaska. Fingers of sleet slushed across the glass, blurring trees into snow and blotting out hills. I'd boarded the Aurora Winter in Anchorage, the state's biggest city, and was now headed inland to Fairbanks. My journey would take all day, but most passengers were on board for a few hours or less. Some flagged down the train from one snowdrift, only to hop off at a seemingly identical snowdrift 20 minutes later. I peered past the drifts into the forests and imagined leafy trails leading to log cabins. Returning to my book, I tried to ignore the groans and grumbling rising around me. They do say that travel broadens the mind. There's a myth that philosophers don't travel. It is fueled by Socrates, who never set foot outside the city walls of Athens, and by Kant, who never travelled more than 100 miles from his birthplace of Königsberg. What's more, the philosophy of travel is not a recognised field of inquiry. There are no books on the philosophy of travel, no university lecture courses, no conferences. Despite all this, many philosophers care about travel. The notion of a travelling philosopher is ancient. Strabo, geographer and traveller writing at the turn of the first century, included those looking for the meaning of life among those addicted to mountain roaming. The wisest heroes were those who visited many places, Strabo said, for the poets regard it as a great achievement to have seen the cities and know the minds of men. Some philosophers travelled extensively. Confucius spent years travelling through states now part of China, and legend has it that his contemporary, Lao Tzu, wrote most of his teachings at a border crossing. Descartes fought as a soldier in Eastern Europe, and later became something of a vagabond. Thomas Hobbes, Margaret Cavendish, and John Locke wandered the European continent in political exile. In the 20th century, W.V. Quine used steamers and aeroplanes to visit 137 countries, and Simone de Beauvoir used her trip to China to write a book. Philosophers have also argued travel is important. Francis Bacon claimed travel would bring about the apocalypse in a good way. Jean-Jacques Rousseau thought it was essential to education. Henry Thoreau believed we would all be happier if we ventured into the wilderness and picked huckleberries. Travel is tangled with philosophy. It poses philosophical questions. Can meeting unfamiliar peoples tell us anything about human minds? Is it ethical to visit the Great Barrier Reef if its corals are withering? Is travel all about men? Further, philosophy has affected travel. The philosophy of space encouraged seaside tourism. Philosophical ideas about the sublime spurred mountain climbing and caving. Philosophy of science produced travelling scientists like John Ray and Charles Darwin, and encouraged every sailor on the high seas to collect far-flung rocks, plants, and cryptic objects of strange operation. The philosophy of travel isn't a thing, but it should be. Asking questions about travel and exploring ways philosophy has changed travel can help us think more deeply about our journeys. Thinking more deeply about things is usually worthwhile. It can increase our appreciation and enjoyment of them. Along the way, this expedition will show that not all philosophers are as hidebound as you might think. Many led lives beyond the armchair. George Berkeley fought off wolves in a French mountain pass. Isaac Barrow battled pirates whilst sailing to Turkey, although he loses gangster points for later describing this skirmish in Latin verse. Why do philosophers care about travel? The 16th century French philosopher Michel de Montaigne offers an answer. Montaigne spent years roaming Switzerland, Germany, and Italy, and his 1580 essays are riddled with reflections on travel. He argues travel shows us the diversity and variety of the world, forcing the soul to continually observe new and unknown things. Travel shows us otherness. We experience otherness when we come into contact with the unfamiliar. It is the feeling that things are different, alien. My favourite travel books describe far-flung places. Sarah Wheeler's Terra Incognita explores Antarctica. Paul Theroux's Great Railway Bazaar encompasses Europe, the Middle East, and Asia. Eric Newby's A Short Walk in the Hindu Kush describes trekking through Afghanistan. These tales convey a strong sense of otherness. Wheeler writes that, in Antarctica, her points of reference dissolved, like the volcanic plumes of Erebus. Theroux describes a bowl of soup, containing whiskers and bits of intestine cut to look like macaroni. Quoting from a Bashgali phrasebook, Newby reveals the harshness of daily life in the Afghan mountains. I saw a corpse in a field this morning. I have 9 fingers, you have 10. A dwarf has come to ask for food. Otherness can explain the distinctions we draw between journeys. All journeys involve motion, change of place over time. Little motions fill our lives. We move from bedrooms to kitchens. We drive to see friends. We walk dogs around parks. Yet when we speak of going travelling, we are thinking in grander terms. We are thinking of journeys such as Wheeler's or Newby's. What's the difference between a trip to the grocery store and a trip to the Sahara? Why is a drive to visit family different from driving through Botswana? The difference between everyday journeys and travel journeys is not a matter of distance. Many travel journeys involve long distances. Wheeler, Theroux, and Newbie all travelled thousands of miles. Yet travel in the grander sense doesn't always involve such distance. Samuel Johnson travelled just a few hundred miles to write his Journey to the Western Islands of Scotland, and Bill Bryson's Lost Continent starts in his hometown. It is also possible to undertake lengthy journeys that are not travel journeys. In Jules Verne's novel Around the World in 80 Days, Phileas Fogg circles the globe, yet tries to avoid experiencing the countries he passes through, being one of those Englishmen who are wont to see foreign countries through the eyes of their domestics. More mundanely, imagine a lawyer flying from London to Hong Kong, sitting through some meetings and flying back again. Her journey would have covered almost 6,000 miles, yet it seems to be an everyday journey, not a travel journey. I think the difference between everyday journeys and travel journeys lies in how much otherness the traveller experiences. Everyday journeys involve just a little, whereas travel journeys involve a lot. Travel writers often aim to increase their experience of the unfamiliar. In a 1950 interview, Swiss adventurer Ella Mayart explains she prefers to travel alone because any companion becomes a detached piece of Europe. Their reactions will be European, and that will restrict her to a European frame of mind. Together, they build a foreign cell. "I want to forget my Western outlook," Mayart said. "Feel the whole impact made on me by the newness I meet at every step." Today, many travellers recommend old-school travel, going abroad without mobile phones or laptops. Technology can cocoon us, wrapping us in familiar weather apps and social media. One motivation for travelling off-grid is to avoid insulating yourself from the new. When and where do people feel otherness? That depends on who we are. Human beings each possess a unique set of memories, desires, beliefs. Language, food, or architecture that is familiar to one person may not be familiar to another. This is why travel books are as much about their writers as their places. If a glaciologist lived in Antarctica and wrote a travelogue about it, she would end up with a very different book to Wheeler's Terra Incognita. Her experience would have been different, because what was different to her would have been different. Montaigne repeatedly reminds his readers that what is new to one person is to another daily habit. Promiscuity, patricide, infanticide. Some societies condemn these practices while other societies allow them. Montaigne argues against exoticizing unfamiliar peoples, against making them appear too different from familiar ones. In an essay on cannibals, Montaigne discusses a group of people from Brazil who reportedly practice cannibalism. He argues this practice is not as strange as it first appears, for historically European soldiers have eaten corpses during famines. There is no harm in making use of our dead carcasses, and it is far less barbarous than the French art of torture. Montaigne goes on to describe the landscape the people live in, their houses, dances, marriages, and gods. These aspects of their lives would have seemed familiar to Montaigne's readers. Their own lives involved dancing, marrying, and worship. Montaigne's conclusion about this far-flung people is sardonic. "All this does not sound very ill, but then, forsooth, they wear no breeches." Travel can be good for us because otherness is good for us. Montaigne tells us that travel is beneficial. It teaches the advantages of bathing, and conjugal friendships are warmed by absence. Even better, experiencing the other improves our minds. Considering new and unfamiliar things forces us to expand and rethink what we know. As traveller James Howell put in 1642, the fruits of foreign travel include delightful ideas and 1,000 various thoughts. René Descartes agrees that it's useful to experience the unfamiliar. He writes it is good to know something of the customs of various peoples, so we do not think everything contrary to our own ways is ridiculous and irrational. Customs are conventional ways of behaving. For example, the British often eat chips with mushy peas. In contrast, the Dutch often eat chips with mayonnaise. Strange though both habits are, neither is ridiculous nor irrational. Travel shows us that our own customs may not be the best. It forces us to question what we take to be obvious. The 20th century philosopher Bertrand Russell also argued that travel is good for us, and that living abroad diminishes prejudice. However, Russell drolly warns against elevating all foreign customs. In the 17th century, when the Manchus conquered China, it was a custom among the Chinese for the women to have small feet, and among the Manchus for the men to wear pigtails. Instead of each dropping their own foolish custom, they each adopted the foolish custom of the other, and the Chinese continued to wear pigtails until they shook off the dominion of the Manchus in the Revolution of 1911. Travel and cultural exchange is desirable, but we must always be wary of pigtails. Several philosophers compared their inquiries to journeys, and I think they're aiming at the same idea. Berkeley likened one of his investigations to a long voyage, involving difficult travel across wild mazes of philosophy. Halfway through his treatise of human nature, David Hume reflects on the trip he has already taken, and on what is yet to come. Methinks I am like a man, who having struck on many shoals and having narrowly escaped shipwreck, has yet the temerity to put out to sea in the same leaky weather-beaten vessel. He is tempted to remain on his current barren rock, rather than venture out onto that boundless ocean which runs out into immensity. Just like travellers through their philosophies, Berkeley and Hume are cutting new paths in the wilderness. They are setting off into the unknown, the unfamiliar, but they implicitly think the rewards are worth it. They are broadening their minds, seeking out new truths. Berkeley proudly describes his philosophical conclusions as a homecoming. Hume the skeptic is less pleased with himself, although he adds that when his philosophical speculations become too cold and strained, he can always make merry with friends and play a game of backgammon. Unfortunately, I suspect it was easier in Montaigne's lifetime to undertake travel journeys than it is today. That's because many of the processes designed to make travel easier in the 21st century also reduce otherness. To explain this, let's go over an argument from historian Paul Fussell. In his groundbreaking book, Abroad, Fussell harangues tourism. Fussell argues travel is different to tourism. Travel occurred during the 18th, 19th, and early 20th centuries. It fused the unpredictable excitement of exploration with the pleasurable tourist sensation of knowing where one is. According to Fussell, there is no travel left, only tourism. Fussell traces its roots to the mid-19th century, when Thomas Cook got the bright idea of shipping sightseeing groups to the continent. Tourists seek things that have been discovered by entrepreneurship and prepared by the arts of mass publicity. Fussell points towards tourist institutions like Butlin's holiday camps or French Club Med vacation villages, where nudity and pot beads replace clothes and cash. Fussell published his travel tourist distinction in the 1980s, and it has many problems. If Fussell is right, then most travellers were European, wealthy, white, and male. No matter how far or how long someone travels for in the 21st century, they will never be a traveller. Although I don't think Fussell was right about that, he was onto something. I share Fussell's intuition that, for a European, journeying to a French vacation village is less travel than, say, Mayotte's trip to Beijing via the Taklamakan Desert. The difference lies in otherness. Holiday packages and tourist villages muffle the unfamiliar. You don't handle booking websites in foreign languages, you don't read local signposts to figure out where you're going. You can hang out with holidaymakers from your own country, order familiar meals in a familiar language. Travel is about the experience of otherness, and some tourist mechanisms get in the way of that. Since Montaigne's day, the world itself has been transformed. Travel writers often lament impending global homogenization, the world becoming everywhere the same. Bill Bryson describes Anywhere, USA. Placeless places that sprout up along the junctions of interstate highways. Purplishly lit islands of motels, gas stations, shopping centres and fast food. These outcrops can be found all over the world, usually filled with the same mushrooms. Best Western, Shell, McDonald's, KFC. Yet complaints about homogenization have a longer history than you might think. All capitals are just alike, moaned Rousseau in the 18th century. Paris and London seem to me the same town. In the 19th, John Stuart Mill entertained similar worries. Europe is losing its remarkable diversity of character and culture, and making all people alike. If the world is homogenizing, it will be harder to experience new things whilst travelling. But it is far from impossible. The trick is simply to get away from what you know. For the Western traveller, that means getting out of Formica airports, avoiding Irish pubs and Starbucks, engaging directly with people and places. As Mayar writes, you can feel as brave as explorers starting for the unknown, the first time you address a witty taxi driver in Paris, or risk climbing down into a Tibetan pub for a meal smelling of rotten meat. It might be harder for us to find otherness, but it is definitely still out there. My own journey into the unfamiliar began in Groningen, a city in the northernmost Netherlands. It's so far to the north that, in winter, night falls at 3 o'clock. I had lived there for several years, and spent most of that time writing a history of 17th century theories of time. The book had become far too familiar. It was mammoth and difficult, and I had finally finished a full draft. I pressed send on my email to the publisher, then stumbled out into the dark. I wandered canals and cobblestraten, peering into bright shops and cafes. I needed a break and began planning a holiday, somewhere utterly unlike quaint, chocolate-box pretty Groningen. In the Vismarkt, I came across a stall selling cardboard sculptures. A silver moose stared down at me, its snout all planes and angles. Blue origami antlers spiked upwards. I decided to visit Alaska. In the weeks that followed, researching my trip to the 49th state somehow became mixed up with the philosophy of travel. Before I quite understood what was happening, I was leaving the library with stacks of books. How to Lie with Maps, The British and the Grand Tour, The Idea of Wilderness. I crammed knowledge into my eyes with both hands. Soon my brain was stuffed with colourful yet useless facts, like a dusty box of Christmas ornaments. Descartes packed 2,000 books on his last fateful voyage to Sweden. Victorian women explorers had ulterior motives for travelling in skirts. Antarctic tourists forget everything they ever learn about penguins. And that was how I ended up in the land of the midnight sun, reading Montaigne. The train journey to Fairbanks was advertised as majestic, and it was. The carriages rumbled through sugar-crusted forests, past lakes dotted with caribou. One length of track spindled out over Hurricane Gulch, a bridge arching 300 feet up. I hung out of the window, woolly hat rammed over my ears, and gazed at the monochrome world of rock and spruce unfurling below. Despite its beauty, for most of the passengers this train ride was ordinary, familiar. They were visiting relatives in Wasilla, or commuting to Talkeetna, or shopping. I was one of the few striking out into unknown territory, travelling into polar Trump country. What is other to one person is not to another. Eventually, the sex noise culprits retreated to the toilet. Meanwhile, the political commentators found common ground in their disgust over Bernie Sanders. He's a socialist. We were all travelling the same route through space, yet making different journeys. 2. What are maps? Brian Harley on Cartographic Deception. I power walked down Fifth Avenue, breath huffing, hands jammed into pockets. I'd flown in from Amsterdam the previous night, and jet lag clutched at me. The conference had started that morning, but the talks on Spinoza and vacuums felt unreal, hallucinatory. I was trying to throw it all off by getting outside. New York smells hung in the air. Baking bread. Pepperoni. Garbage. A fragile March sun appeared, gilding the pavements. I gazed upwards through zigzagging fire escapes. Pigeons cooed where the sky flared blue. Using Google, I found a second-hand bookshop. Bells tinkled above the door, the only bright thing about the place. I found a sales clerk and asked about maps.
Wrapping paper?
His face screwed up.
We don't sell that here.
Ah, no, I said in my troublesome British accent. After a quick chat about Harry Potter, I was free to explore the map section. Edging between bookshelves into a gloomy alcove, I stepped carefully to avoid spilling papers over the floor. Orange ordnance surveys overhung their shelf. Rows of atlases formed uneven teeth. Kneeling down, I hunted through ranks of red Rand McNally's. I would arrive in Anchorage 2 weeks from now, and I wanted to make plans. At the very end of a row, I found an Alaska state map. I smoothed its accordion folds flat, the paper rippling over my shoes. Once unfolded, the map lit up the space. Islands and coastal ridges edged against the sea. The landscape glowed white and green, delicately veined with roads and rivers. The Yukon River branched across the paper. Dots traced the Alaskan oil pipeline. Livin' Good, Dead Horse, Moose Creek, Coldfoot. The place names read as though the mapmaker had enjoyed adventures. Maps are all around us, all the time. I had rarely spared their nature a thought. What is a map? My yellowing copy of James Monteith's First Lessons in Geography defines a map as a picture of the whole or a part of the Earth's surface. Before I began research, that sounded about right. The description fit my Google map of Manhattan. Sure, maps don't have to be pictures in the traditional sense. You can build a map out of clay, or weave it into a tapestry. You can tattoo a map onto your body. World map tattoos were a trend in 2016. Nor do maps have to depict the Earth's surface. Maps can depict things above and below us. Weather systems, underground metros, oil reservoirs. Maps can also depict things beyond the Earth. Moons, stars, black holes. If Monteith wanted to be more precise, maybe he should have said that a map is a visual representation of any part of reality. But, I thought, he was basically there. That was my thinking until I began reading about the philosophy of maps. The word map comes from the Latin mappa, meaning a white cloth, like a flat tablecloth. Humans were making maps before they made Latin. The oldest surviving world map was painted around 8,000 years ago on a cave wall at Jeora in Madhya Pradesh, India. Until the 20th century, people defined maps in largely the same way Monteith had. On this definition, maps are transparent. They are what they appear to be, representations of reality. This doesn't mean that maps must be complete or accurate. Historical maps are neither. In the first century, Plutarch complained about geographers filling the margins of their maps, such that beyond the known world lies only sandy deserts full of wild beasts, unapproachable bogs, Scythian ice, or a frozen sea. Look at these maps in Figure 2.1 from Thomas Burnet's 1684 Theory of the Earth. Burnet labelled large portions of these maps incognita, unknown. Today we label them Washington State, Canada, Antarctica. The maps are wildly inaccurate. Most of Australia is missing. The mapmaker has sliced an island off the western edge of the United States. 18th century maps contained so many inaccuracies that travellers were advised to carry compasses and note down where maps were faulty. As human science and technology has improved, so has the accuracy of our maps. Satellite imaging represents our planet with never-before-seen accuracy. We can be confident we are not missing any major landmasses. I have always held a transparent view of maps. Atlases, just a kind of book. Country maps, helpful for planning overland treks. City maps, useful to find museums. I was convinced otherwise by Brian Harley's 1989 article, Deconstructing the Map. Harley used philosophy to show us the dark side of maps. Metaphysics is the branch of philosophy that investigates reality. It asks, what is real? What could be real? What are real things like? Metaphysics usually studies the things around us, atoms, material bodies, our minds. Yet we can turn metaphysics on anything, and Harley turned it onto maps. He argued we can break maps down into parts and show that, far from being straightforward, maps are complex and opaque. They are objects of influence and power. Metaphysically, maps are deceptive. Harley provided two lines of argument. First, Harley showed that maps are rhetoric devices. Maps are seeking to persuade or influence their readers. Throughout history, map makers have placed their homeland at the centre of their world maps. Harley argues that what is, and what is not, centred in a map, is a rhetorical choice. Centering Athens or Jerusalem on a map adds a subtext of geopolitical force to what appears to be a straightforward representation of the planet. Similarly, consider what maps do and do not represent. Take my Netherlands Road Atlas. This map highlights castles and churches, while townhouses are inconspicuous. It traces the boundaries around country estates and ignores boundaries between farms. The map achieves this by...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.